Hello, friends and skeptics and haters alike. You are all welcome today to pull up a chair and join in the discussion. Regardless of what your opinion might be on the circus that was the Justice Kavanaugh hearing, the whole thing highlighted the point that the entire topic of sexual assault is an incredibly difficult one and emotionally charged for obvious reasons. But it's not just a topic, it's a reality, and it's one we need to be able to hash out in a civil manner, without shutting down the opposition with screaming and ad hominems. Or with the implication that people who have experienced sexual assault are on one side of this issue, and those who haven't are on the other, which simply isn't true. Now, the Me Too movement was first to turn the national spotlight on this issue in a big way, and not in a just way. But then the Kavanaugh nomination and subsequent hearing has exploded the national conversation about how we handle sexual assault allegations that have zero evidence, which is good and necessary, but there's no easy answer. Now let me first make a note here that in this video I'm primarily addressing male-on-female rape cases. It's a terribly one-sided view because males are raped by males and females alike, but feminists tend to ignore or deny this and emphasize the plight of females. So I'm willing to meet them on their own turf for a moment, as it were, and challenge their conclusions starting from their very own premise. Let me also first note that I consider rape to be a crime so vile that it deserves to be punished to the fullest extent of the law, if not much further. It's one of the reasons that I actively support organizations that rescue victims of sex trafficking, and why I oppose how many women are treated under fundamentalist Islam. You will not find me ever trying to minimize the nightmare that is actual rape. This video simply has to do with situations in which we cannot be certain that it happened. So let's get right to the crux of the matter. What do we do when there's an accusation and no evidence? A friend and I were discussing this issue a few months ago, actually as it pertains to rape specifically, not general assault, which can be incredibly vague and ill-defined. We agreed, as can most reasonable people, that due process is necessary. But from there, what? We know that a startling number of rape allegations are false. More than feminists will admit are false. But many are not. There isn't always evidence to accompany the allegation, primarily because sometimes people don't go to police right away, as they should. What about when a woman actually is raped, but there's zero evidence, corroboration, etc., so we can't possibly know for sure? The question then becomes, do we allow a potential rapist to go free, or do we ruin a potentially innocent man's life? What an awful question. There's no easy answer here. But what is certain is that two wrongs cannot possibly make a right. Or if we must put this in terms of sex, our daughters are not of more human value and worth than our sons. Our daughters are not more worthy of justice than are our sons. We've all seen the stories. Men who were falsely accused of rape, imprisoned for years, and were themselves raped repeatedly while there. 80% of rape in the U.S. occurs in male prisons, a statistic which is even more sobering when you consider that men are less likely to report rape than are women. These men suffered only to be exonerated years later when their accuser confessed to having lied. Check the National Registry of Exonerations. It should bring tears to your eyes. Still others are falsely accused, imprisoned, and never exonerated. What of the falsely convicted who don't have the resources, the finances, or even the knowledge to have their case further investigated by, say, the Innocence Project? And we haven't even addressed a third category, men who are never brought up on charges, but are fired, kicked out of college, or forced to resign from positions in their communities based on accusation alone. This happens regularly. Career, finances, reputation, dignity, and sometimes life obliterated. Men who account for over 73% of suicides kill themselves over such things. Most of us cannot even begin to imagine the horror of this nightmare, a nightmare in a system which legally wronged these men. We expect to be wronged by criminals, but we expect justice from the courts, a justice system which showed them none. Now, our justice system can never be perfect in this world, I get that. We cannot attain perfection, but we had better make sure we are wielding it with excellence. There's a difference. And what we're seeing across America is not even close to being that. Can assault occur without evidence, or at least without witnesses? Yes, absolutely, it often does. But can we lock someone up without a shred of evidence? No. What do we have left, judicially speaking, when the justice process is gone? We have cases like Emmett Till. We have mob rule. This is one of the primary reasons for a justice system, so we don't convict innocent people, so the innocent are not taken advantage of, exploited, coerced, by the threat of false accusation, so we don't exist according to the law of the jungle. Must we state the obvious? That imprisoning people on an allegation is unethical and unjust? Not to mention that memories themselves can be inaccurate, even unintentionally so. Please see the link to the psychology article below that addresses the science of this. Prominent feminists shamelessly tweet bold-faced falsehoods such as, "Women don't lie about rape." We all know better. We know women lie about rape. This is demonstrable and indisputable. And Christians, if you aren't already familiar with hundreds of such cases, you should at least be familiar with Potiphar's wife. What did Joseph do? Was he not raised right? Nope. The man was above reproach. People have been raping and lying about rape since the dawn of time. Now, feminists tend to make two arguments in this regard. One, but that happens so rarely. And two, most rapes go unreported. First, if it were true that false rape accusations are rare, what is the point? What's the conclusion of that? How rare do they have to be to justify taking someone's word alone and not requiring evidence? Oh, once in a while we'll just have to destroy an innocent man's life for something he didn't do. Are you kidding? How often do men have to be falsely accused for them to matter? How often for us to question allegations rather than blindly believe them? I want a number, because 2% and 5% are not enough. Feminism has made that very clear, as that's how much they're willing to concede that it happens. What percentage is enough? In other words, what happened to the presumption of innocence and due process? It reminds me of statements made by rabid radical feminists like Emily London, the Teen Vogue columnist, who said she's, quote, "not at all concerned about innocent men losing their jobs over false allegations," and, quote, "if some innocent men's reputations have to take a hit in the process of undoing the patriarchy, that is a price I am absolutely willing to pay." Never mind that the price is paid not by her, but by these men. The narcissism. You want to talk about an agenda, about a radical ideology, about the end justifying the means? But it so happens that unfortunately false allegations are not rare. It's 8 to 41% of the time that we know of. See link below. I've also read pieces estimating it's closer to 86% of the time, and everything in between, but all of these numbers are always hard to know for sure. For every woman who lies about being raped and later admits that she lied, how many lie and don't admit it? Don't confess. Feminists say that 2% of allegations are false. More accurately, they're saying 2% are proven false, but even those who hold to this wrong statistic must acknowledge that the number is higher, unless they're going to make the deluded argument that every single false allegation is eventually exposed, which of course is not the case. And to the second point, that most rape is unreported, that's misleading phrasing. The truth is, a certain amount of rape is unreported. We don't know how much. It's the perfect boogeyman because it can't be proven one way or another. It's frequently used to support the feminist narrative because the assumption and the claim is that there's this huge number of women who are too scared to report, and therefore we live in a rape culture. Ignoring that massive leap for a moment, let's examine how feminists arrive at this conclusion. I mean, if it's unreported, how do they know it happened? The answer? Surveys. No data. The claim is that 60% of rape and sexual assault goes unreported. Note that this includes sexual assault, so it's false to say that much rape goes unreported in the first place. The exact wording of the survey is, and I quote, "Have you been forced or coerced to engage in unwanted sexual activity?" Keeping in mind that men have been fired for sexual assault for actions so malicious as touching a woman's arm or placing a hand on the knee, how do these word-of-mouth surveys, which allow individuals to define sexual activity and therefore sexual assault in any way they wish, with no accountability, make any sense at all? If they were based on data, or there was some way to vet these answers, then we could take these surveys more seriously. But to call them reliable sources of information as it is truly a joke. Here's something else to think about. If you're going to make the assertion that women are afraid to report and therefore there's this colossal number of women who aren't statistically factored in, what does that say about men who are even less likely to report being raped or sexually assaulted, especially by a woman? A woman who says she was raped may be believed or she may be questioned, but when a man says he was raped, especially by a woman, people literally laugh it off. I cannot count the number of times I've heard, "Oh, he got lucky," or "I wish she'd been my teacher," or "Women can't rape." If you think that women aren't believed, then you must also acknowledge that men are believed even less. Heck, the media officially won't use the word rape to describe a woman forcing a man to have sex against his will. So to pretend that this is even primarily a women's issue is absurd. Now, truthfully, many prominent feminist ringleaders do not actually care about women. They're more about furthering the Marxist feminist agenda and down with men. But many of your average coffee shop feminists who are unfamiliar with feminism's nasty aims and origins call themselves by the title because they do care about women who've been sexually assaulted, and they think that feminism does too. Here's a glaring question that I have for these individual feminists to consider. Why then isn't feminism at large condemning the women who lie and making it harder for society to believe real victims? Why isn't feminism actively educating women on how to take sensible steps to protect themselves from rape? You can argue that no woman should have to fear rape, and I could not agree with you more, but we do not live in an ideal world. We exist in a world where there are rapists. My husband and I agree that robbers shouldn't exist and that teaching people not to steal begins in the home, but we still lock our doors and protect ourselves against home invasion, because it happens. Human trafficking is grotesque, and people should be taught not to use people. But I'm not going to let my toddlers wander out in public without me, because children are kidnapped. Protecting yourself against rape isn't somehow caving. It's only damaging to the feminist narrative that there's nothing you can do to protect yourself, and that to say otherwise is victim blaming. A lie that ironically puts more women at risk. And saying, no, we need to educate men not to rape, is ludicrous because most men don't rape, and the ones who do will not be stopped by an educational program that tells them don't rape. Likewise, you can argue all day long that women don't report sooner because of fear or any number of reasons that should be addressed, and there are many. But that does not change the fact that it's despicable to convict someone who hasn't been proven guilty because they weren't reported. This goes for all forms of crime. You can talk all day long about how unfair it was that you were wronged, and you're absolutely right, but if you don't report the crime, that criminal can't be brought to justice. Rape, of course, differs from other forms of sexual assault in that there is always physical evidence. Not necessarily the same kind of evidence, but there is always evidence. So go to the police. If you have a shot at putting a rapist behind bars, do it. Don't use "I might not be believed" or anything else as any kind of excuse. If you at least report it, have that on record. You've done the right thing, even if, God forbid, the police do the wrong thing and never investigate. You can then never be accused of fabricating it 50 years later for monetary gain or something. But this touches on the fact that one of the reasons many women don't report it right away is because they didn't know it was rape until they were told that it was. Many women have simply regretted the encounter, and over the years this resentment turns their memory from "I shouldn't have done that" to "he shouldn't have done that." That's another topic in and of itself, and again, please check out the article below. It isn't compassionate to anyone to minimize and downplay false rape allegations. It is delusional to say that pushing to criminalize liars will prevent more women from coming forward, when it is the liars who create doubt and prevent them from coming forward in the first place. It's delusional to argue that we shouldn't talk about false allegations because it might somehow minimize the heinous nature of rape itself. The whole reason that being falsely accused of rape is so heinous and so egregious is because the crime of rape itself is so heinous and so egregious. So here's my challenge to and my homework for the National Organization for Women and all the other feminists out there. Start lobbying for harsh legal action to be taken against women who are proven to have lied about rape. Start actually educating women on the common sense stuff that their grandmothers knew about avoiding sketchy situations, because many such situations can be avoided, contrary to popular belief. And start encouraging women to report actual rape to put more rapists behind bars and off the streets so they don't prey on someone else. Those are steps that would in reality help women. That would be feminism doing what it claims to be about. Spoiler alert, they won't, though, because organized feminism is neither primarily nor fundamentally about actually helping women, unless it occasionally helps convince more women to join the ranks. For more on that topic, see my video called "Why is Feminism So Confusing?" And to those of you hashtagging "believe the woman" because you believe that women are in a particularly vulnerable place in society right now, I implore you to think outside of what you've been told and to consider for one moment how much more risky it is to be a man right now. Please hear me out. I, as a woman, have a better chance of protecting myself from rape than a man has of protecting himself from a false rape allegation. I can abstain from drinking alcohol. Alcohol is involved in at least 50% of sexual assault cases. See the link below. I can make sure I'm never alone with a man. That would do it. Or I could concealed carry. You could argue, if you wish, that those are extreme steps to take, but the point is that if I do everything in my power, I can all but eliminate my chances of being raped. If a man does everything in his power, he is just as much at risk. He need not have even met the woman, much less have done anything inappropriate, to be accused. As just one simple anecdotal example, Dr. Ben Carson was falsely accused by a woman he'd never met, who mailed him pictures, and when he rejected her amorous overtures, she falsely accused him. Here are two statements that are certain. Some people rape, and some people lie about rape. The problem is, it's okay in our culture to spread the message that men rape, even to say that we live in a rape culture, but it's not okay to talk about the fact that women lie. Whether or not we live in a rape culture can be argued one way or the other, depending on your definition of rape culture. But that women lie is an indisputable fact. Yet the outrage and the silencing tactics that you'll face if you attempt to point out that women are capable of lying is bizarre. That is a problem. Food for thought. Thank you, as always, for taking the time to watch and for sharing your thoughts. If you appreciated this message and think it's one worth spreading, please feel free to like, share, and subscribe. You can follow me on Facebook and Instagram or shoot me an email at christy0misty@yahoo.com. Thank you again, and I hope you have a wonderful day.